Easter Sunday. This is the day that the church is all about. It's all about our new beginning that we have in Jesus, about how he has entered into our world and into our lives, how he has made sure that everything that causes us any harm or desires to do us any type of damage in our lives, that those things have been vanquished, and that we can stand fully in the presence of God, filled with his grace and mercy. Before we get started, I do want to call your attention this morning to the announcements that are printed in your worship guide. Please take note of all of the things that are taking place here at the church over the next few weeks. The thing that I want to share with you today, and I'm so excited about this because it involves Drew's favorite thing, candy. At the end of today's service, you will see up front on the pew, there are two baskets filled with wonderful goodie bags. And these goodie bags are filled with the candy that was supposed to be in our Easter eggs that we were going to have for our Easter egg hunt yesterday. But the rainy weather caused us to kind of rethink everything and say we need to do something else. And so Miss Linda, Miss Barbara, Miss Melissa, Mr. Tommy, and who else was up here? Miss Judy. They painstakingly took all the candy out of the eggs and put them in these beautiful bags and tied a ribbon on them. And so my message to you this morning is to, when service is over, or you know the standing rule here, if things get a little slow during worship and you're like, man, I could use a little surge of sugar, you can come forward and pick them up during worship. It doesn't matter to me. It's not going to cause me any harm. But if you would, at the end of service, take as many of these bags that you can take with you, but not for yourself, Drew. Not for yourself. I'm going to ask you to take a bag of candy and one of these green little pieces of paper. On this green piece of paper is an invitation for you to take this piece, this bag of candy and this invitation, and you're going to give it to a neighbor, a coworker, a classmate, an enemy even. That's what the gospel tells us to do too. Somebody, I want you to take as many of these little candy bags that you can take with you and hand them out this week and invite a friend, co-worker, classmate, enemy, whomever it is, to come to church here at Homewood Church. We're going to be starting a series called Living the Resurrection over the course of the Easter season. And this is how you can help get people to invite people to come to the church. So I want to invite you to take a bag of candy and a green piece of paper. And this week, that's your homework. That's your homework for the week. To invite someone that you know, love, maybe don't love, to come to church and join together in our fellowship. So that's the big one announcement that we have, to which there was much rejoicing. And I'll even say this for those like Drew in the room. I'll even let you take one for yourself. Just take one for yourself, son. Not right now. You can take a look at all the other announcements that are there printed in the worship guide. But now I want to turn this over this morning to Miss Melissa as she comes forward to give us our children's message.
Hey, good morning. So last week our word was Hosanna, right? So pray God save us. So this week, our word is hallelujah. So you're going to hear hallelujah a lot today. We're going to sing that quite a bit in the choir. We're going to say it in some verses. So it's a phrase that's going to be, a word that you'll hear. So hallelujah means God be praised. And our verse that goes with that is 1 Peter 1:3. And it says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Today, the whole circle comes back around. We see the whole picture, the whole process, and what it is that it all means when it comes to this point today. So let's say a word of thanks about that. Just
call to worship is based on Luke chapter 24. Anytime, if you see in the worship guide any text that is italicized and or bolded, that is where you are invited to respond and join with me in our liturgy. The Lord is risen. Alleluia.
Alleluia. The Lord is risen indeed.
Let us pray. Glory to you, O God. You have won victory over death, raising Jesus from the grave and giving us eternal life. Glory to you, O Christ, for us and for our salvation. You overcame death and opened the gate to everlasting life. Glory to you, O Holy Spirit. You lead us into the truth. Glory to you, O Blessed Trinity, now and forever. Amen. We begin this celebration this morning with the singing together of hymn number 367, verses 1, 3, and 4 of Christ the Lord is Risen Today. But this Sunday morning, is a day where we see and understand and proclaim that final hurdle that we all have to face, that hurdle that is called the enemy of death, has been conquered. Therefore, we can live confidently, knowing what Jesus has done for us and the reason why. We can all sum up all of that truth into our baptism as we sit and we think about how God has spoken His word over us in our baptism. Some of us were baptized as infants and we don't remember that day. Others have been baptized as adults and you remember it clearly. But the only thing that we have to remember today is that when we have entered into this place, we have done so at the mercy and by the grace of God, and we are His children. And so let us give God thanks this morning for our baptism into His name. O Lord, our God, we give You thanks for the new life You raise up in us through the mystery of our baptism, the sorrow of the heavy cross, the surprise of the empty tomb, the love that death could not destroy. By the power of Your Holy Spirit poured out upon us in baptism, fill us with the joy of the resurrection, so that we may be a living sign of Your new heaven and new earth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Friends, the Lord says, come. Let anyone who wishes to take the water of life as a gift, come. It is trusting in God's grace then that we do come before Him and we confess our sins. And we do so first silently this morning and then together with our prayer of confession. Friends, let us pray. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends, let us pray together. Almighty God, in raising Jesus from the grave, You shattered the power of sin and death. We confess that we remain captive to doubt and fear, bound by the ways that lead to death. We overlook the poor and the hungry, and pass by those who mourn. We are deaf to the cries of the oppressed, and indifferent to calls for peace. We despise the weak and abuse the earth we've made. Forgive us, God of mercy. Help us to trust Your power to change our lives and make us new, that we may know the joy of life abundant given in Jesus Christ, the risen Lord. Amen. Friends, Scriptures tells us that all of us, like sheep, have gone astray, but now we have returned to the shepherd and guardian of our souls. Brothers and sisters, in the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen. We continue in celebration by singing hymn number 357, verses 1 and 3 of Christ Arose. I invite you to please stand.
Jesus, our Savior,
comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, verses 1 through 15. Brothers and sisters, I invite you to listen carefully this morning, for this is God's Word. Now after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled the stone back and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And behold, he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. See, I have told you." So they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy, and ran to tell his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them, saying, "Greetings." And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." While they were going, behold, some of the guard went into the city and told the chief priests all that had taken place. And when they had assembled with the elders and taken counsel, they gave a sufficient sum of money to the soldiers and said, "Tell people his disciples came by night and stole him away while we were asleep. And if this comes to the governor's ears, we will satisfy him and keep you out of trouble." So they took the money and did as they were directed. And this story has been spread among the Jewish leaders to this day. Friends, this is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Thank you.
Fear is a powerful thing. Fear is something that can control us. It is something that can be used against us. It is something that others can use to cause us to do things. It can cause us to make decisions. Fear is a real enemy to each and every one of us. Now, we know that there are some good things, though, that aren't so difficult about fear, or that makes our lives difficult. There are some things that we should have a very healthy fear of, and I'm not going to go through that list of things that we should be afraid of. One thing that I probably think we shouldn't be afraid of, but I have been afraid of the majority of my life, is that of clowns. I think clowns are something that have proven themselves time and time and time and time again that they are not to be trusted, nor should we even have like any kind of audience with them, right? Again, to me, that's a very rational and reasonable thing. To others, it's not, and I apologize to any clowns who may be gathered here this morning. I don't mean to cause offense. But fear is something that will cause us to make decisions and do things that we may not want to do, maybe forced or coerced into doing. Fear is a real issue. When we read into the scriptures, we see that fear is not just something that we have to fight with and things that we have to deal with in our lives, but fear is an ever-present thing in the scriptures. Many times, whenever we see God interacting with humanity, anytime you see an angel of the Lord coming before someone whom God has called to hear his voice and to hear what he has to say, that angel will have to tell the people that are the audience, do not be afraid. Fear not. And a lot of that was probably very well founded, right? If y'all read the book of Ezekiel and you read the description of an angel in Ezekiel, they are quite terrifying sounding. We tried to sit in men's Bible study a few weeks ago and try to come up with our minds, what does this messenger from the Lord look like with all the eyes and the arms and the heads and all of these things? And we really could not wrap our minds around that. So it really makes sense that whenever God comes and talks to his people or to individuals and the angel is there, people cower. People cower in fear. And so they have to be told, do not be afraid. Now, we all know that sometimes those words don't work. I've been told before, going back to my other fear about clowns, I've been told, don't be afraid of the clowns. They're just human beings. But in that time and place, my mind can't make that correlation between one and the other. But I still have a fear, and I want to stay away from them. That is a silly fear, by the way. Hopefully you don't know that. But there are things in life that causes us to be afraid. And what do when we're afraid but cower? We try to get away. We try not to be in the same place or in the presence of whatever it is that causes us fear. Sometimes whenever we're in situations with people and we are afraid or we're scared, somebody might say, hey, you don't need to be scared. Don't be afraid. Be brave. Which can be empty words when bravery isn't there to be had. Sometimes our fears cause us to be paralyzed, immovable, unwilling to do what it is that we've been called to do. We may think, and it's probably true, the opposite of fear is bravery or courage. But what do we do when bravery and courage isn't there? There has to be some other antidote, some other solution to fear. And Easter Sunday presents to us the solution to how to beat fear. And that solution is resurrection. That solution is being alive. disciples, as they are living in the wake of the crucifixion of Jesus, they are afraid. Some of them have scattered away into hiding. They're afraid because they've seen what happened to Jesus. And not only have they seen what happened to Jesus, they also heard what Jesus had said. And in many of Jesus, and of all of the things that Jesus told his disciples, one of them, the things that he said to them, was, "A servant is no greater than his master," which has to elicit a bunch of fear. Because the disciples have not only seen with their very eyes what happened to the Savior of the world, to their rabbi, to the Messiah, to the Son of God, whom they have come up next to for the 3 years prior to these events. Not only have they been with him and seen him and gotten to know him, they've seen all the things that he's done. They've seen those demon-possessed who were given salvation from those demons and they were cast out. They've seen dead people overcome death and be raised again. They've seen blind people with their vision. They've seen lame people be restored to walk. They've seen the lower classes in society be restored. They've seen those with great sin be forgiven. They've seen all of these things happen. On that Good Friday, it all came tumbling down for them. The one who was able to command the winds and the seas and command the demons and command illnesses to be gone or to be calm, he has seemingly breathed his last. Breathed his last upon a cross. They had to be. The one who had told them before and had comforted them through so many difficult times was now gone. And we know that in the narrative of Holy Week and on Maundy Thursday to Good Friday, we know that many of the disciples, all of them save one, they abandon Jesus. They abandon him and they go into hiding because they are afraid for what might happen. On resurrection morning, though, we see the remedy of that fear, the solution to fear in living color. The ladies that Jesus had been traveling with, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary, in keeping with the traditions of the time, had returned to the tomb to anoint Jesus' body because, and I will quote what Luke chapter 11 tells about Judas. We all know when people die, they begin to stinketh. So Jesus is going to have his body anointed with oil by these ladies who truly believed everything that he said. But they were going to anoint his body with oil. And when they arrive at the tomb, they see something completely different than what they were expecting to see. And again, that is the story of the gospel. It's seeing things that are completely unexpected. Seeing things that we're not prepared for. As they are coming to the tomb in another gospel, we know that the ladies are actually trying to discuss how are they even going to get into the tomb. That stone was really big, and they couldn't move it out of the way. But in Matthew's gospel, we see that when they arrive, the tomb has been rolled away. There's an angel there. The tomb is empty. And those words, "Do not be afraid," I imagine echoed into the tomb outward for everyone to hear. Do not be afraid. To compound the fear of the women and the disciples, now there's a grave robber on the loose, right? Probably what some are thinking. We know that in another gospel, in fact, Mary asks that very question. Who took him? He was here just the other day. Who took him? Jesus. The Jesus that had died and was buried was alive and well and in glory there at the tomb. And Jesus meets up with them and he tells them what the message is. And we see in verse 8 that they depart quickly from this interaction with the angel, and they have great fear, and then something that doesn't often come accompanied with fear, great joy. They don't know what's going on. They don't know what this means for them. Boy, are they joyful. Jesus, their Lord, is no longer in the tomb, and they now have a message to tell others that he is risen. And so while they are still kind of gripped by fear, they go then to tell the disciples, who themselves are probably quite fearful. We know that they lock themselves in the upper room. They do not want to face the same fate that Jesus faced, having to go to death. Some of them had even begun thinking about and planning what next. Sound just like us, don't they? When something happens, we try to figure out what's the next steps. Some of them had resolved to say, well, I guess I'll go back to Dad and do some fishing. I'm sure Matthew may have gone back and said, I wonder if I get my job back at the tax collecting booth. Trying to plan, they're trying to figure out where they're going, but these ladies come back to them, these women come back to them and pronounce the good news. They should not be afraid that Jesus is risen. And not only is he risen, the ministry continues. The story continues forward. We're to go to Galilee and we're going to meet up with Jesus there. On this Easter Sunday, friends, as we sit here in this place, I invite you to kind of look into your lives and put yourselves into this position of these disciples, these men and women who have been so dependent upon Jesus, but they don't know what the next day has in store for them. They don't know what is awaiting them into the future. And all that they have is his word to go. Go to Galilee. Remember, they're in Jerusalem. They have to go north to Galilee. An exposure. People are certainly going to run into them. People that they've met before. People who know how they are connected with Jesus. But they are to go, nevertheless. To go and await the word of Jesus. What are we afraid of in our lives? Many of us are afraid of our pasts. Many of us are afraid of our presents. Many of us are afraid of our futures. Many of us may look back into our past and we may see that there are things there that have been very troublesome to all of us. We may have had battles that maybe have gotten the best of us. Battles that have caused us to think less of ourselves. Some of us have had battles in our lives that other people know about, and it causes them to think less of us. Some of us have fears about how our life fits into the great puzzle of creation. Some of us may think that our stories aren't as interesting as the other person across the pew from us. And what does that fear do? These fears cause us to withdraw, cause us to pull back. It may cause us to keep our mouths closed. It may keep us from entering into some place or to some relationship because we just don't know what's going on. Happen. The story of Easter is Instead, trust. Trust in the resurrection of Jesus, which, by the way, happened. It seems to be pretty cool and chic these days to try to reinterpret the crucifixion of Jesus and the resurrection of Jesus into some morality tale or some type of allegory about things. But friends, the Christian church has proclaimed since its inception that he is risen, that he died, but he is risen. This is what the Gospels tell us. It's what the epistles tell us. It's what Paul tells us in his Corinthian correspondence. When he tells the Corinthians there, who are probably dealing with some of the things that we have to deal with in our lives, when people say, hey, Jesus didn't really die, and Jesus didn't really go to the grave, and he wasn't really resurrected. And what the Apostle Paul says in the 15th chapter of 1 Corinthians is that if none of that happened, if none of it happened, if Jesus didn't live, die, was buried, and was resurrected, if none of that happened, then we're all doomed. And in fact, we're more than doomed. We are the biggest fools that have ever lived. Now, the resurrection is real. It happened. And it has continuing impact throughout all of history, up to today, into our lives, and into the future, into the lives of everyone else that we meet. We've always tried to boil down, right, in Christianity, to the bare minimum, or a bumper sticker type thing, and some sort of message. And you know, one of those messages is sometimes you might be the only person, or you might be the only Jesus someone else sees, which is kind of true. But that's not what it's all about. We're not Jesus. We point to him, certainly. And in each of our lives, there are those ups and downs, those successes and failures, those things that we're proud of and those things that we're ashamed of. And in all of those things, Christ is present. Christ is there. Christ's grace is there, and it's not meant for you to just keep to yourself. It's not meant for you to just keep it on a post-it note on the mirror as a word of affirmation for the day. No. This Sunday, this story of resurrection is about Jesus, and it's about us. It's about us being born again. It's about us looking like we looked, but not acting like we once acted. It's about us who once were doomed to death and separation from God, but now have a place at his table. Our stories are important, for they link us with Christ, and when we tell those stories like these two Marys did in the Gospel of Matthew, it connects other people's stories to the same risen Lord. I've used a lot of words this morning to say this. Friends, you matter. Your life matters. Your stories matter. They're important. These stories of failure and success are to be able to point others to Jesus. Those times in your life that you wish would just go away and that you would never remember in some mysterious and gospel-centered way, that very story that you wish never happened has some measure of gospel truth for someone else to hear. And so, friends, as we consider our lives and consider where we are to go, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid of where you are, the station in life where you are now, the struggles that you have now. Do not be afraid of individuals and what they may think or how it may impact your life. Do not be afraid. But go and tell Jesus' brothers and sisters about how he is raised from the dead and how he has raised you from the dead and has given you a life worth talking about. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends, I invite you this morning to affirm your faith with me in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Friends, as we are gathered here this morning, I want to invite you to the table of the Lord. This table does not belong to Homewood Cumberland Presbyterian Church. It does not belong to the Cumberland Presbyterian Church. It belongs to the Lord Jesus. And the Lord Jesus has prepared a place for each and every one of us at this table. And so this morning, if you are here with us, if you are a believer in Jesus, you are invited to partake this morning of the supper that Jesus has given us. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise, O holy God, creator and ruler of the universe. You created light out of darkness and brought forth life on earth. You formed us in your image and called us to love and serve you. When we were unfaithful and turned from your ways, you did not forsake us. Your love remains steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and sent prophets to call us back to your way. In the fullness of time, you sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Savior. In him, your word, dwelling with you from all of eternity, became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth, and we beheld your glory. Emmanuel. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with the celestial choirs and with all the faithful of every time and place who forever sing to the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are holy, O God of majesty, and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Born in humility, he came to rule over all. Helpless as an infant, he showed the power of your love. Poor in things of the world, he brought the wealth of your grace. Rejected by many, he welcomed all who sought him. In his dying and rising, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. We give you thanks that the Lord Jesus, on the night before he died, took bread, and after giving thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me. Remembering your gracious acts in Jesus Christ, we take from your creation this bread and this wine and joyfully celebrate his dying and rising as we await the day of his coming. With thanksgiving, we offer our very selves to you to be a living and holy sacrifice dedicated to your service. Praise to you, Lord Jesus. Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Lord Jesus, come in glory. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, that we may be one with all who share this feast. United in ministry in every place, as this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. And Father God, watch over us as we go about these things in your name. For we ask this in the name of Jesus, who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Empower us by your Spirit, O God, to be Christ's presence in the world, even as Jesus was God with us. Give us courage to speak his truth, to seek his justice, and to love with his love. Keep us faithful in your service until Christ comes in final victory, and we shall feast with all your saints in the joy of your eternal realm. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. I want to invite the elders that I've asked to serve, if you would, come forward at this time. As these come forward, I want to invite you that as the plates are passed, to take the bread and to take a cup, and if you would, hold it until all have been served, when we will all partake together. parents, with thanksgiving, let us eat and drink. Let us pray. Father God, we rejoice that the grave could not hold your Son, that he has conquered death, risen to rule over all powers of this earth. We praise you that he summons us into new life to follow him with joy and gladness. By your Spirit, lift us from doubt and despair and set our feet in Christ's holy way, that our lives may be signs of his life and all we have may show forth his love. Praise, glory, and thanksgiving to you, our God, forever and ever. Amen. Coworkers. whomever you may have upon your heart, and invite them to come to church. And also, if you have an offering, the tithe plate is up front here at the conclusion of service. If you want to, you can place your offering in there. Receive now this benediction. Beloved children, may the love of the Holy Triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit abide with you forever. Alleluia. Now go forth in Jesus' name, remembering his new commandment, to love one another just as he has loved us. Amen.
Sir, it's good to see you. All right, Mike.